Hey everyone, welcome back to Tech Talk. I'm Juliet Beauchamp. I'm here with Ken Mingis, Executive Editor at Computer World, and Matt Egan, Editorial Director here at IDG. And we are talking all things Brexit, what that means for data protection laws, what's going to happen with GDPR once the UK, if and when the UK leaves the EU. So stick around. So Matt, thank you so much for coming all the way, our resident UK resident.
Thank you so much for having me.
So the date is fast approaching for the hard deadline to leave the EU. Mm-hmm. And that's going to mean a lot of things for UK residents. But something that's really going to be interesting for UK organizations is how, like us here at IDG, is how that's going to affect data protection and users' data and how the free flow of data will work. So can you tell me a little bit about how what the current law in place is in the UK and the EU?
Sure. So the GDPR, which has had a pretty significant impact on both the way that businesses use data and individuals' data is used, is the result of an EU directive, which basically says that as a user, you have the right to control how your data is used, to ask what data is held by companies, to ask for it to be deleted, to understand how the company is using that data. It was a European directive which the UK adopted into law in 2018. So that law will stay in place. It's kind of important to understand that Europe doesn't really make laws. It makes directives that member states bring into place. So the basic principles, which I think we all would agree are pretty good, will stay in place. And actually, I believe this year in the US, something similar is coming into law. So that's good. The challenge for the UK, which is allied to many other challenges for the UK with this whole leaving the EU thing, is nobody actually knows what it means in terms of the UK's status as a country within the GDPR. So as it stands currently, you can share information between countries with the user's permission if they're within the EU, because we're all considered equal in terms of law. But when the UK leaves, particularly if the UK leaves with no deal, then presumably we become a kind of unknown quantity, what they call a third party country, which will severely restrict how a business like ours actually can share data across territories within the EU.
Is there any timeline yet, Matt, for when we'll know whether there's going to be a hard Brexit, a soft Brexit, or anything in between?
Well, certainly when we started this recording, Ken.
It may have happened over in the last few minutes.
Something of a movable feast. I mean, as it stands, to Juliet's point, the deadline is the end of March, essentially. Right. And the way the politics are playing out right now is it's very much being seen as we will leave at the end of March. There's an element of brinksmanship around that without going into too much detail. And the honest truth is this is one of those rare occasions in history and politics where nobody really knows. It is conceivable that, and the EU has in the past said, that if the UK asks, this could be extended and it could go further, because although data is extremely important, it's probably not as important as the supply of medicines and foods and so forth, which are also kind of being considered at the minute. So it's conceivable that we will leave with no deal at the end of March, in which case, who knows what will happen? Then it becomes kind of an unknown, and we'll see how it goes. It's also conceivable the whole thing will be delayed, and it's possible that these things will be ironed out in the intervening time. But with the current political deadlock, that seems unlikely.
Right.
Sure. So with the potential of leaving with a deal, something like data protection laws is certainly something that could be negotiated into it. But like you were saying, if there is a hard Brexit, a no deal Brexit, and the UK leaves, it's sort of this third party mm-hmm. nation, and there wouldn't be that immediate ability to share data with other EU countries. What would the process for becoming recognized by the EU, being able to share data with the EU, what would that process look like?
Well, again, it's unprecedented, so nobody knows, but the basic principle has seemed to be that, you know, all these things are negotiable. So for instance, if we think of the free movement of people physically, there is this thing called the Schengen Agreement, which means non-EU countries have a deal with EU countries. Switzerland is a classic example of this, that allows people to have the freedom of movement that currently, for instance, the UK has with France and Spain and Ireland, that you don't need to go through checks at a border point to get through. So there is a principle that says a similar agreement could be reached with data. And it is definitely the case that the EU has, you know, is seeking these kind of relationships anyway, right? So there is, most businesses like ours within the US have already adopted GDPR style policies because we have audience in the EU anyway, so you might as well go to that standard. And the standard makes sense if you're someone who respects your audience and you respect your customers. And that does mean that there is a willingness and an understandingness within the EU to make exceptions and have exceptional countries who are considered known third parties, if you like.
You know, I'm curious, do you have any sense? I mean, GDPR has only been on the books, I think, since last May. Uh-huh. And I've seen, you know, it sounds like there's been sort of a slow rollout in terms of companies being fined. I know that there was I think a French agency had fined Google something like 50 million euros for some issues last month, and some smaller fines. Do you get the sense that while 2018 was the year of basically educating companies and consumers and people about data protection, that 2019 may be the year where we're going to start to see some larger fines, assuming that there are breaches and issues?
Yeah, I mean, there's an element of speculation in this, but I think that is the case. I mean, there was definitely, if not explicit language, there was definitely the idea that companies would be given a chance to get their house in order. In fact, part of the language is about being seen to have a policy and communicating it within your business. And we were given guidance that, you know, there had to be an appointed chief data officer and that person had to communicate certain policies around the business. So not that you get a free pass, but if you happen to make a mistake, but you'd done the prep work and it was all perceived to have been done in good faith, then it was explicitly stated that you wouldn't be pursued by the authorities. There's also the question of how enforceable this law is, right? Because you get to the stage where a company like Google kind of has to choose whether or not it pays tax in certain territories, and it kind of gets to choose whether or not, it pays a fine to a specific country because it can up sticks and move to a different place. And you know, there is some precedent for this. So at the same time, if you're a smaller business, you might not even get noticed, frankly. It would require someone to complain about you, ultimately. So I think there has been a general tenor around this stuff, which is the laws all make sense. It's good principle. Nobody legitimate anyway, really wants to be in a world where data is treated badly and where it's kind of a Wild West situation. So there is an element of people are given a chance to get their house in order. But to your direct point, I think probably 2019, you're less likely to get away with a breach than you might do in 2018.
Yeah. Yeah, makes sense.
Yeah, that does make sense. So at this point in time, if a company is online, if they're a tech company, they're an international company at this point. It's not like there's any company that can say, well, we are based in the UK, so we're...
There may be some North Korean companies who don't really do much international business, but yeah, I think
they're probably not going to be too worried about GDPR.
No. So since there is pretty much anyone can access anything online, how would a no deal Brexit affect the EU as opposed to the UK? So we know the UK would have to apply for...
So from the other side,
yeah, basically. From the other...
That's a really good question, actually, because the UK law was written essentially to mirror the GDPR. So I don't know if then, and I suppose it's conceivable and therefore possible that the EU becomes a third party to the UK, which again is in no one's interests. So I suppose the short answer to that is I don't know. The good reason for that is I don't think anybody knows. And one of the things that has been talked about is that, you know, this idea of a no-deal Brexit leading to an immediate wasteland with marauding gangs roaming around the country is unlikely to be true, because the principle that will be adopted is what was law yesterday will remain in principle law today, but it will need to be renegotiated. So in this instance, that is, and that, I suppose there is an element of leverage there, because the UK is a very valuable market for most EU operatives. So nobody wants to go backwards in this state. Well, many people in this conversation want to go backwards, but let's talk specifically about the GDPR and data. Most businesses want to be able to do business as easily as possible. And so I guess in the same way as a business like ours, which is truly international, adopted GDPR globally, because why wouldn't we? I think the EU member states would want to do business with the UK and so would probably accept some level of quid pro quo around that.
I'm curious, you know, stepping back from just the GDPR, whether or not the uncertainty around Brexit is having any kind of chilling effect on business, in particular, you know, tech business. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've certainly seen things. We were talking about this yesterday about the Honda plant that's being closed. And I saw some story that said that if there's a hard Brexit, that travelers from the UK who are in Europe might suffer roaming fees when mm-hmm. they're using their phones. I mean, it's almost like being this weird sort of different class of citizen. Have you gotten any sense, you know, whether companies, and I guess since, you know, we're looking at tech companies, whether they're, you know, nervously eyeing this or whether they're just going to wait it out and hope that everything sort of gets muddled through?
Yeah, so I think, I mean, and to pick up one point there, it is explicitly being a different class of citizen, because right now anybody in the UK, any UK citizen is a European citizen as right. well, and that will go away. So it does have a personal impact on that level. I think there are two levels of approach to this. There's a lot of uncertainty, full stop, and that right, is definitely right. impacting the economy. If you deal with physical products, so car manufacturers
Honda,
are a classic
for
example,
instance, yeah.
right? Then it becomes like even those who are sort of remaining committed to the UK are talking about pausing production because they literally don't know how they're going to get products in and out. And in a just-in-time world, it's very difficult to plan production if you don't know how long it's going to take you to get car parts through a port, which is literally what we're talking about at this stage. If you're making cars only for the UK all of a sudden, then you're going to make far fewer cars, mm-hmm. right? So that has definitely had an impact. However, within the part of tech which is virtual, it's more just a level of uncertainty. So, you know, an example would be like nobody really knows how VAT is going to work right across Europe into the UK, right? But we can all mitigate risk for that and say it'll probably work broadly speaking the same way. The UK is still a great place to do business. So maybe we'll wait and see would be a good way of looking at that. I think one of the other challenges that people have is around personnel. So a big play for the UK is the language is spoken in the US, which is quite kind of important. And geographically, actually, the UK is nicely placed between the US and Asia. And therefore, lots of companies have big workforces in London that are multinational workforces. And this is London specifically, mm-hmm, actually, which is right. a problem all of its own anyway. And again, we've got some experience of that in our own office where we have people from Spain and France and Poland, none of whom really know what the long-term future is. So that is another source of anxiety and therefore insecurity for businesses, and tech businesses are big employers of those kind of educated transient people. So it's a much lower level of anxiety currently, and very few tech companies are making the right now active decision to exit the UK in the way that some of the manufacturers are. But I think it's definitely there, but it's kind of a wait and see type of thing.
Okay, good. So at least it's not hellscape on March 30 or the 31st.
No, but I mean, you might be seeing a bit more of me in future.
Okay, you know? That's great. We like having you here. This is great. It's our Brexit expert. A Brexpert.
Oh, I like that.
There you go.
That was good. I think it's, like you said, how when once the UK leaves, there's going to be that sort of sense that what was the law yesterday is still going to be the law mm-hmm. today. That's kind of interesting just in how that's going to be enforced, in particular with these data protection laws. Mm-hmm. I mean, if I'm on a website, I find this a lot if I'm on a .co.uk website, if I'm looking up like Love Island information.
Of course.
And I always get a sort of that privacy mm-hmm. notification. And I just wonder, small things like that, is that going to change?
I don't know, really. And that in and of itself has been quite an interesting thing, because that is really an interpretation of the GDPR mm-hmm. that then became widely adopted. But it's not, you know, you don't specifically have to put that message sure. up there. That's just been seen as a way of gaining consent, which is a very important part of the GDPR. It's always interesting to me to be in the US because it's not there, and that's kind of strange, right? You know, because I'm just used to every single website you go into it being there. I would say it's unlikely people would remove it, because it's a good way of mitigating risk for the business, mm-hmm. and the user behavior has become such, and we can measure this, that people basically just click
I do. Click yeah and keep reading.
I mean, if people were sufficiently concerned about the use of their data, they wouldn't be using social media for a start, you know. So you know, that level of consent, and again, just speaking for our own publications, you can see that a tiny percentage of people actually go in and change the levels of consent that you can give, which is the opportunity that you can give. So I think it would probably stay. Because again, why would you take the additional risk of, to our previous conversation, being somehow targeted by the European Union when it's a relatively trivial thing now that it's in place to have the...
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I do wonder, too, if this is going to prompt the U.S. finally to get on board with some of the privacy regulations mm-hmm. that have been debated here in Congress. I don't know how much you track that, but I think California is moving forward with its own sort of statewide mm-hmm. Regulations, which would then spill over to probably the rest of the country. Yep. I'm not sure we're going to get anything out of Congress this year. There doesn't there doesn't seem to be a lot of interest in regulation these days out of D.C. But I do think that because the Europeans have sort of planted the flag that, you know, people are more aware, they almost have to be,
yep.
about data protection, privacy, and how, you know, both valuable and fragile that data is in, mm-hmm. in terms of keeping it protected. So I think it's a good thing. And that's what led me to that question earlier about whether we're going to see bigger fines this year. Yeah. I think that's going to be the big way to get enforced. Get people's attention.
And of all the states in the union, California is the one that from a media and tech perspective really matters, right? And from an economic perspective,
yeah.
right?
So it's it's the fifth biggest economy in the world, I read right. today. Yeah.
So California making that decision essentially makes that decision for almost every data holding company in the US.
Right.
So, you know, in effect kind of thing, whether it's regulated elsewhere or not. I guess you might find that there's this kind of pockets of places where they do things differently because they can, in the same way that we see that with taxation within the US, you know.
Sure.
But I think, you know, certainly if I think about our business, like once California makes a regulation, we're going to adhere to that.
Because, as California goes, yeah. so goes the US, I guess.
Yeah, absolutely. So I was also wondering, Ken, I'm just seeing that you have this article pulled
yeah.
up, that a French data protection watchdog fined Google.
Mm-hmm.
And I wonder if how those sort of, I mean, that's a wonderful resource that all of the EU really benefits by this French watchdog group's organization's work. And I wonder, this is more of just a hypothetical, I wonder if the UK will still sort of enjoy that opportunity that, you know, these other countries mm-hmm. It's not that the UK doesn't have a cybersecurity watchdog or
no, but
agency,
it does, like, as with cybersecurity, as with everything else, it does, you know, there are, how can I say this in a balanced way, that there are pluses and minuses to being able to make your own decisions and being part of the bigger gang, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's another example, or that is a good example of how what happens in one member state is then led to other member states, you know. And that's not always good, and certainly there are people within the UK who would say we don't want to, you know, have the way things are approached dictated to by a group, an unwieldy group of lots of different countries. But there's definitely a certain loss of strength in numbers, I guess.
Yeah, that's very interesting. Thank you so much for coming in. Yeah, have any other thoughts?
No, Ken? I think that covers it. I guess we're going to wait and find out how much we muddle through all of
yeah.
this. We'll have you back in a few months if you can, you know,
if
you can get out. Yeah, exactly. If you make it. If it turns into a hellscape, you can come back.
Great. Thank you guys so much. It was really interesting. And I mean, the great thing is that we're not going to have to wait that long to find out how this plays
that's
out
right.
unless the UK pushes back.
Yeah. I'm glad that you think that's a really great
thing.
I predict it's a muddle.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's true. So thank you so much for watching this episode of Tech Talk. If you like this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up, subscribe to our channel, and be on the lookout for new Tech Talks coming soon. Thanks.